It's all good.
Yeah, I'm at your disposal, as they say. If you want to dispose of me, you can do
it. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa sahlan. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Wa salatu wa salam ala Sayyidina Muhammadin, Ashraf Anbiya, wa Sayyidina Mursaleen, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Alhamdulillah, bismillah. Welcome everyone, inshallah, to the Mihraab Foundation and ICOE program with Shaykh Hashim Ahmad. Alhamdulillah, we are honored and grateful and privileged to have a great scholar with us this whole weekend. Alhamdulillah. And inshallah, just to kind of get started and introduce the program and then the weekend schedule. Inshallah, tonight's talk will be about Hollywood, from Hollywood to Mecca, by Shaykh Hashim Ahmad, inshallah. We're excited to hear about his personal story, mashallah. And inshallah, we'll do that talk for some time. And inshallah, if we have time at the end, we'll do a Q&A and then close with dua. And then after that, inshallah, there'll be some samosas and chai as well, inshallah. And then tomorrow, just to let everybody know the schedule, 10 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., there is another program with Shaykh Hashim Ahmad, inshallah, about a meaningful, healthy living. And it will be at Cordoba in Linwood, inshallah. And there will be a lunch break from 1:30 or from 1 to 2:30. And that will be provided by the Mihraab Foundation there, inshallah. So everybody's invited for that free event tomorrow throughout the day, 10 to 5:30, inshallah. And alhamdulillah, if you want to know more information and to see the flyer, the details, the address, you can go to mihraab.com, M-I-H-R-A-A-B.com. There were some questions earlier about the live stream. So those who can't take it to attend in person, you can see the live stream at the Mihraab and Facebook YouTube pages, the Mihraab YouTube and Facebook pages online, inshallah. Without further ado, we want to introduce our great and well-known, mashallah, beloved Imam Shaykh Hul, to introduce Shaykh Hashim, inshallah. Jazakumullah khair, barakallahu feek.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I don't know if I'm beautiful. Subhanallah. Yes, alhamdulillah, we are very, very fortunate. Subhanallah, that we have Shaykh Hashim tonight. American Islamic scholar, teacher, holding degree from Jamia Umul Qura, former musician by profession, grew up in Los Angeles, spent his teenage years there during the 1960s in pursuit of his musical career. During the same era, the urge to acquire spiritual development and perfection continued to become more and more predominant until he realized that there it alone lay the secret of true success for men. And we'll find many musicians in that time, in the 60s, 70s. And you'll find Yusuf Islam, Cat Stevens, you know, and you look at the music of a lot of other, I don't want to mention it, but it was during that era, you know, where for also to, you know, to the Beatles and John Lennon and all the other these things, like, you know. And so they were searching for something. Alhamdulillah, Allah gives hidayah. Mm. He therefore left America in 1970 in pursuit of the true and pure path towards spiritual development and the real meaning and way of life as prescribed by the creator of the universe in its original form. After extensive travel and search, he finally accepted Islam in Ethiopia in 1970, Habasha, subhanAllah. Rasulullah sent the Muslims there because it was a very kind king there, you see. And the king himself accepted. And Rasulullah performed his salah, ghaib, you know, when he died also. He eventually took admission in the Jamia Umul Qura in Makkah Mukarrama, where he completed a degree from the faculty of Dawah wa Usuluddin, with specialization in the sciences of Quran and Hadith. He thereafter was deputed by Sheikh Abdul Aziz bin Baz, rahimullah ta'ala, then Chief Mufti of Saudi Arabia, as a teacher at Jamia Ulum Islamiyah, Binori Town, Karachi. He served at the Jamia Ulum Islamiyah, teaching various Islamic subjects in the Arabic medium from 1985 to 1992. From 92 onwards, he taught at Madrasa Aisha Siddiqa for girls in Karachi and later one of his branches, Madrasa Maryam, very famous madrasa for the girls, for our daughters, mashallah, that blossomed and mushroomed at that time. And then from there also, you find many, many girls' madrasas throughout the whole world. It's just like, alhamdulillah, we have here in Seattle also Darul for girls. We have 45 girls also studying Quran and Hadith. In 1997, he began to develop a company known as Al-Khair Creative Quality, where based on Islamic and professional excellence, we specialize in beneficial products aligned with a healthy, meaningful lifestyle. The Al-Khair business model has devolved into an entire Islamic business system known as the Ubudiyya business model. Shaykh Hashim headed a team of scholars and professionals who are involved in the research and development of the model and devotes a large portion of his time in further developing, presenting, and sharing the UBM model to the business community and others. Presently, Shaykh Hashim serves as a religious director at Darul Falah in Tustin, California, seminary instructor of the Institute of Knowledge, senior instructor at Darul Ashrafiyah, and continues presenting lectures and workshops on promoting a healthy, meaningful lifestyle. And from there, we can learn more about his passion at hmlevy.net. Alhamdulillah, I was had the fortune of attending Sheikh's program in Darul Salam in Chicago. Many of us from here, I think, attended the program at that time, the retreat, the three-day retreat. And he did the final dars of Sahih Bukhari, Khatm al-Bukhari. So alhamdulillah, we benefited a lot. And inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, infinite mercy, benefits us tonight and during the weekend also, inshallah. So without much further ado, I hand it over to Shaykh Hashim, inshallah. Please, brothers, be mindful, respect of others also. And keep your, mask on at all times. And our children are being disruptive, the little ones. We ask you to, kindly leave the room now. It's not inconvenience to others also. Jazakallah.
So after sort of throwing on my head these accolades, which of course I don't deserve by any means, I would like to thank the administration and our young ulama and our not so young ulama who have facilitated this gathering. And of course, in these gatherings, the special rahmat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes down. So it's not about any particular individual, it is about the dhikrullah. And when people gather for the dhikr of Allah and to remember Allah, then it's loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He remembers such gatherings in much better gatherings with Him. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us a naseeb, a portion of that great virtue, and make us among those. So this is basically a talk about my journey. And actually, it's not a talk about my journey. It's a talk about really, if we really analyze it, it's a talk about how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yukhriju al-hayya min al-mayyiti wa yukhriju al-mayyiti min al-hayy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He brings the life out of the dead, and He also brings the dead out of the living. You can't hear? How is it now? Is that any better? Is that okay? So basically, my journey is just a manifestation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's special mercy. Otherwise, me knowing who I am, where I came from, sitting here and talking about deen and talking about it's an unthinkable proposition. So I was born in Cleveland, Ohio, 1950. And 1950s, of course, was a time just after the World War. That's why we're called the Baby Boomers. I really don't like that name too much. But because after the World War, after Second World War, things kind of boomed here. After the Great Depression that my father, lived through. And then we had the World War, then we had this big, and it was actually connected to the whole change of mentality and perspective, which was changing from a traditional divine-based system of life to the new industrial age. We talked about that in our little talk in Juma, right? Insan afi khusr, because he's looking at himself, he's not looking at the bigger picture. So this is what happened, back in the 1950s, so people were now okay, material success, industrialism, factories, you know, careers. And so I was born in a family where my father comes from a Jewish family. And I say he comes from a Jewish family in the sense that they're traditionally from Jewish heritage, but there was nothing religious in our house. In fact, the house in my very early childhood, we lived in front of a synagogue, which I never saw the inside of it. So in fact, the religion of our house was enjoy your life. You know, like Nike says, just do it, right? And my mother, it comes from a Christian family who, interestingly, they were actually Protestants. And my great-grandfather was a very well-known missionary priest who spent most of his time in India. And he's well-known there until today. And actually, and his sister, my great aunt, she was a surgeon, an eye surgeon. Can you imagine the turn of the century? And she spent 50 years or more in India. She's buried there. She lived her whole life there, serving Christianity. And she was the only one, fast forward, she was the only one in my whole family who actually objected to my becoming Muslim. And we didn't even know her. She didn't know me. But she heard in India that she has a great, great grand, whatever, who has now become a Muslim, and she wrote a big treatise that why you shouldn't have done that. So on my mother's side, they're Protestants and they have that, but my mother was not religious in the traditional sense, although she believed in God though. And that was a kind of bone of contention between my parents because my father was a very staunch atheist and we were brought up as basically atheists. You know, religion is, you don't talk about that. There's no God, there's no unseen, there's nothing like that, you know. The other aspect of our family was we were all musicians. My father was a very talented musician. My mother was a very talented singer. They're both alive. By the way, before I forget, I request all of you, please, my parents are still alive, but they have not accepted Islam. And my father is now terminally ill. He's really on the last stages. Inshallah, next week I go to Phoenix to visit him, and hopefully he'll remain, you know, until then. And just we hope that he'll say the kalima, even though he's that staunch atheist and unbending. But Allah's great. So please make dua for him. Allah let him leave this world with iman. And my mother as well. So that was the environment of my house. So there was no religion in our house. The religion was, one thing was the music. So we're all musicians. I was a child prodigy from the age of four. I, you know, used to spend my, you know, waking hours listening to classical music and hoping to become something like that. And then by the time I was around 7 or 8 years old, I was playing in the family group. So our whole family had a group and we would travel around, among other things. And my father was also, he was a businessman from a business community. And also we're very connected, however, because of my mother, we were very connected to natural things because my mother was an organic gardener back in the 1950s, can you imagine? And she was also a student of one of the early, you know, sort of nutritionalist movement that was started. One of the important gurus of that era was a woman by the name of Dr. Adele Davis. And so my mother was a student of hers. And so we grew up with a very natural sort of life, you know. And there wasn't Coca-Cola and candy bars and all that kind of stuff that was taboo in our house. And we also always had an organic garden and we used to eat from our garden. And then my father and mother were very enamored with horses. So we grew up with horses. I used to have to read horses. Like you have the little kids are, you know, especially in India and Pakistan, they're beaten, you know, to read Quran. Well, we were beaten, you know, to ride because we used to have to go to the horse shows on the weekend. We would go with the horses, and my father and my elder sister and myself, we would go and perform in these horse shows where we'd have to. So that's, you know, my early childhood. And then ultimately my father thought that, well, I want to dedicate my life to horses and Western life and all that kind of thing. So we left Cleveland and we went to Durango, Colorado, where my father with a couple of other partners bought 500 acres of pristine forest area, which is, you know, right in the middle of the Rocky Mountains. And so we developed a guest resort. It's called a dude ranch. I don't know if anybody's heard of that. It's where the dudes, you know, of, you know, hey, dude, you guys don't know where that comes from. Actually, dude means somebody from the city, you know. And that's what originally where that term comes from. And so we would recreate the Western cowboy kind of early, you know, cowboy lifestyle, and people would come from all over the country and spend a week, their whole family, riding horses and learning to shoot guns and shoot archery and hunting and all this kind of thing. And we used to facilitate all that. It was a very wonderful experience, actually. And that period was very significant in many ways, but the most important thing that I would mention at this point was that since we're out in the middle of nowhere in these beautiful Rocky Mountains, so my favorite pastime was to take off by myself up into the top of these mountains and scale these mountains and just marvel at the universe. And I think this is where really my spiritual journey began, because I would just spend hours and hours just looking, you know, just observing the sky and the mountains and creatures, and it was just so awesome. And then this whole concept that my father had, you know, instilled in us that, you know, it just happened in this Darwinism whole thing, and, you know, it didn't make sense. All this creation and no creator? Come on. How is that possible? Anyway, I didn't actually form any perception as say, but the connection with nature and the beauty of nature, that was something that was very key. And I mentioned that because this is very important for us, particularly our youngsters who are, we were mentioning, growing up in the concrete jungles of these American cities. You know, there was a story that one lady was showing her son that, son, this is called a tree. Oh, what is that? You don't see trees even. You just see concrete. And if you do see a tree, it's like lit up with the lights. It's not a real one. So we need to actually connect with nature. And our children need to connect with nature. My mother, who's 94 years old now, she says one of the, probably the, she attributes her longevity to working in the dirt from her childhood. Hands in the dirt. When we were children, we played in the dirt. In fact, I was known for eating dirt when I was a small kid. So when you're involved, so all of the bacteria and the fungi and all of that, so your system is used to that. Look at we're all wearing masks and we're all afraid of these little COVID bugs, you know, because we don't have immune systems anymore. We don't have natural defense system because we live such an unnatural life. Anyway, so in Colorado, in the early 1960s, that was the later on in my childhood, and then in around 1964, so my parents were having difficulties. However, one thing I really have to appreciate about my parents, that even though they were having very severe conflict in terms of their marriage, but we children never, it never became apparent to us. They used to conceal that, you know, in such a way that we never really knew that. And then one fine day we were told that we're going to go and visit in California. So we all left and came here with my mother in Los Angeles. My grandparents had settled in Los Angeles quite a long time ago. And so now this young musician finds himself in Los Angeles, which is the dream of every musician, right? Hollywood. So I began high school in Los Angeles, but I never really attended much, even though I was a music major, but I wasn't really interested in what theory. I was interested in hands-on. So I didn't really attend much school. I never was much of a student, and I didn't like what they were teaching me. So I started actually joining groups and joining, you know, the musical groups and pursuing that career. And also another very important aspect of that period was that as a child in Cleveland and then, you know, growing up in Colorado, so we don't see other types of ethnicities. We don't see other types of people. However, my father being, we were all musicians, my father musician, he was also enamored with, you know, jazz and rhythm and blues. And one of my favorite One of my favorite musicians from the very early on was Ray Charles, who was, died some years ago. And so I love the music of the Afro-American community. And even though I never met an Afro-American, but I was enamored with their music, and I used to play their music. And so in Los Angeles one time, I was what we call in music jargon jamming, you know, playing with informally with there was a neighbor of mine, and one of his friends was an Afro-American jazz pianist. So we used to play together. So he told me one day, he said, you know, you're one of the few people that can play our music, but you know what? You need to get the culture. I said, oh, yeah, that makes sense. So we were living in, and I don't know if you know Los Angeles, but it's Santa Monica and Beverly Glen. It's like right near Beverly Hills, right? So then what he's saying is, if you really want to play our music, you have to get our culture. You have to, what is music? You know, even we're not going to get into, you know, this halal, haram and all that, you know, I don't want to get into that discussion, but it is an art form and it is an expression. So any art form is an expression of feelings. And feelings are the outcome of an environment, think perceptions. And so what do these Afro-Americans feel? Why? They have a music form called the blues, you know, and you might have heard this. I got the blues. I'm troubled. I'm feeling sorrow. I'm feeling frustration. And so we call that in our jargon, the blues. So then I decided, yeah, I should take up that advice. So I left Beverly Hills and I go down into the ghetto and live in the ghetto to get the culture. And that was a life-changing experience, you know, and seeing how in the same country, here is a whole different country altogether, a country within a country. And these people are living in a total different paradigm. Total different circumstances, total different, you know, perception from the other, you know. And I was baffled, you know, and I was really, and that was, of course, that was the 1960s. We had the civil rights movement going on. So now even being right down there, you know, and with music and being, you know, these are my people now, you know. So I got heavily involved into that. And in so doing, of course, Malcolm X, who was one of the main spokesmen in that era. So I became a very, you know, devoted, you know, appreciator of his, although I never met him, unfortunately. But I read his autobiography and it was just stunning. And that was actually the first thing that I heard about Islam, was through his autobiography. At the same time, we had, you know, we had that whole hippie movement. Have you heard of hippies? I don't know, they kind of died out or something, you know, but do you have any idea what that was about? Most people, they really don't, because particularly we Muslims, alhamdulillah, we've not had to been exposed to all of these kind of weird lifestyles. But what it was our generation in that era, we started questioning things like the American dream. The American dream, what is that? The American dream is like our ancestors came from wherever, Eastern Europe, Western Europe, wherever. And here we're going to live the dream, the American dream, which means, you know, like we've mentioned, you know, in Juma, a big house, a big car, a big bank account, you know, good food, good clothes, because actually people didn't have those things, you know. And so since that was the focus and the criteria of success, so people thought we're going to get really a good share of that over here in America. Well, they didn't realize, along with that share of material wealth, you're going to get a huge share of travail, tension, stress, you know, civilizational diseases, ma la tuaddu wa la tuhsa, that cannot even be counted, and the dilemma of, you know, modern society, modernity. So we started questioning this American dream. Are you kidding me? It's more like a nightmare, you know. We've got inequality. We're going around the world bullying everybody, and, you know, trying to force them into, you know, complying with our concept of our material capitalism that should dominate. You know, come on, really. And so our generation questioned all of these things that were held to be, you know, the ideals, And we said, wait a minute, where is the liberty and justice? Where is all of that really? Right? So this hippie movement was a kind of speaking of the fitrah, of the inherent human nature. It was speaking to us, but without guidance, you don't reach your destination. You know, you know that you have to go on a journey. You know that you need to go to a new place. But where is that place and what is it? You haven't got a clue. So you just start roaming around, and roaming around without a map and a compass, you generally end up nowhere. And that's what happened to most of us in that particular, you know, in that movement. So that whole hippie thing, that whole love generation, peace and love, and, you know, that just kind of died out because there were, and very few of us were guided to actually Islam. Some of us were very fortunate, very small group that actually was guided to Islam. So anyway, so now I'm pursuing my career, and on the one hand, you know, I'm seeing, you know, now, you know, living with and interacting with the Afro-American community and seeing what's going on there. Then we've got the civil rights movement, all of that. Then we've got this whole hippie movement, and then the sort of challenging of the established status quo, you know. And then in show business, may Allah save all of you from having to enter anything like that. Of course, I think here that, you know, IT business is pretty much the same thing. Allah help you all, really. You know, it's all pretty much the same thing. So you have, you know, you have artists who are poor people who, you know, have perceived things, they have artistic, you know, inclinations, they perceive things as, and they want to express that in various art forms. And then you have people who understand that that's saleable, that's marketable, we can make money on that. That's the business side of Hollywood. And it is really, 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 really sick. And so that's why you find, you know, most of my colleagues, they never saw 30 years of age. So in that business, if you're particularly if you were a musician in those days and you live over 30, you're going to live a long time. Like, see the Rolling Stones? These guys are still alive. I mean, they were tough, because if you make it past that, you're really tough, because the lifestyle is so intensely, you know, bizarre. You know, leaving, you know, all the toxic of the drugs and all the perverted lifestyle. And then you have to deal with the business side of it that just treats you like, you know, you're just a commodity to be sold, you know. Sports is the same thing, right? You know, you were making money, well and good. You're not, you know, spit you out and that's the end of it. So I'm... And then in the late 60s, I had a sojourn in Japan and with a group there, and we became actually very famous in Japan. And but again, you know, that whole, and I had a huge, you know, collision with RCA Victor, who I was working for. So then when I came back from Japan, actually, I could never settle back down. And at the same time, at that particular time, our generation was also realizing that, yes, religion is not necessarily what we have been told, you know, this, you know, what's been handed down, you know, go to the church on Sunday, sing some songs, and Jesus is going to take care of it. He's got your back. Don't worry about it. Do what you want to do. But moreover, we started realizing that the human being has a spiritual aspect, which being starved, the human being is really being stifled. And so this whole idea of spirituality started to really kind of blossom. The hippie generation, and you know, these hallucinogenic drugs that they use, LSD and marijuana and all that, actually what the use of that, they were trying to find a spirituality. So since they didn't have real spirituality, so they would find it through these drugs, you know. And so that's actually the search for real spirituality. But again, very few people were able to really be guided to the real thing. So most of it just kind of fizzled out or, you know, died away. So that being the case, so I was also being part of that whole scene. So I got into all of these, you know, anything spiritual. I mean, as I mentioned earlier, so I was already attracted to those kind of things by nature and all of that. So meditation came, and then yoga and Hinduism, Buddhism, and any kind of ism that was, you know, talked about spirituality, just gobble it up, right? So anything they can put in, but at the end of the day, I would come to the conclusion that, well, that's kind of nice, but it's not giving the whole picture. So I just ended up not being satisfied with any of those systems. And I don't say I became an expert in any of them, but at least the little that I was involved, it just didn't seem to be the real thing. And then seeing that we have all of these disciplines, and then also it gave a new perspective to what these prophets perhaps were really representing, like Jesus and Moses and Abraham. So these people were all talking about a creator, and they were talking about a way of life that the creator has prescribed that we're supposed to live so that we can connect. Now, during this period, one of my, you know, as I, you know, when I was a smaller, younger child in Colorado, so I used to continue that tradition, you know, even in my musical career, you know, playing in these nightclubs and all that. Seattle, I used to play here in Seattle also. Seattle, Portland, all in Vancouver, we used to go up and down all this West Coast area. But I would always, you know, we would have 2 or 3 weeks of a stint, we call that a gig, and then we'd have a break, and I would invariably take off to either Big Sur in California, the mountains. Have you seen Big Sur? Beautiful place, one of the most beautiful places on the earth, I think, you know. It has sentimental value to me also, but either Big Sur or this, or the desert, San Bernardino Desert. I used to go out there by myself and just stay out there for days, fast, do yoga, meditate, anything, all the spiritual stuff that I learned, and just connecting. And then ultimately, in Big Sur, the last time that I had been there, it just dawned on me. It just sort of kind of like I felt I was kind of like just merging with the whole cosmos. It was a very kind of a strange experience. But it just dawned on me that that's what life is about. You have to connect with the creator. That's what life is about. That's the real thing. Everything else is it's meaningless. It's just it's useless. And so I came down from those mountains, and I had determined that I would, you know, take off. And now, where would I go? Because, you know, everyone in those days, you know, who was on that journey, their Mecca was India, and ultimately Tibet. You know, to go to the monasteries of Tibet and with the Buddhist monks. That was like the big hijrah. But since everybody was doing that, and I was a nonconformist, no, I don't want to do that. I want to do something else. Where would I go? And where would I go? So I want to go where I think the real original form of this lifestyle that these prophets were teaching, it must be somewhere, right? The creator has created this whole creation. He must have kept, you know, that system pristine. Because I realized that the Bible had been changed so much, you know, it's unrecognizable, really. You know, the message that was given to Esau, it's nowhere to be found, really. And I realized that there was a lot of weird things that, you know, people put into these religions that were not really there. Where's the original one? Where's that? So, with my very limited research, I didn't, you know, do a PhD on that, you know, but I, whatever limited resources that I could lay my hands on. And being connected with Africa also, right, with Afro-Americans, and that was the kind of music I used to. So I was, you know, I would like to be in Africa also. And so I came to this, came to find out that early followers of Jesus, because by the way, you know, at that point, 1960s, you don't hear about Islam. You know, Islam is the biggest thing in the news now, right? You know, every other thing is about Islam, unfortunately not very negative and not very positive. But in those days, you know, nobody heard the word Muslim, Moslem, M-O-S-L-E, a Moslem, you know. Muhammad, so nobody heard. The only Muhammad we knew about was Muhammad, Elijah Muhammad. You know, that certainly wasn't, you know, that wasn't, you know, we weren't looking for that. Okay, so we didn't know anything about really Islam other than Malcolm X, you know what he said. So that's the only thing I knew about Islam, what Malcolm said when he went to Makkah and he went through, you know, North Africa and he saw all different types of ethnicities living together, white, black, all colors. And wow, you know, how did they do that? That's awesome. So I was very impressed with that. But that's all I knew about Islam. Otherwise, the last prophet that I was aware of was Jesus, alayhi salam. And I knew that his, you know, teachings were totally corrupted. And so where are the original ones? So in my little limited research, I came to this perception that perhaps it's in the mountains of Ethiopia. Why? Because they say that the early, you know, followers of Jesus, and mind you, as our Imam mentioned, you know, the Najashi, rahmatullah, who actually died as a Muslim, that was a very important center of Christian learning and Christian assembly. It was a fully Christian, you know, dominated region, and so they were very old in their, you know, in their having become Christians, and they had established, you know, their scholarship there, and they claim that the original teachings have been, you know, preserved by the monks in their monasteries in the mountains of Ethiopia. I said, okay, I'm going there. You know, and being that kind of young hippie, you know, revolutionary type of me, so okay, I'm going to do that. People are, what? Do you know anybody in Ethiopia? No. Do you speak their language? No. Do you have any contact? No. Then how in the world, you know, what are you going to do there? It's very interesting. This is only a small fellow. He did that. I have nothing to do. So somehow I had this perception, well, what I'm searching for, he knows. He's going to take me there. SubhanAllah. That was, you know, the great favor of Allah SubhanAllah, that he just kind of gave me this idea. And that was a hippie concept, by the way. There was this hippie concept which has something to do with the Hindu idea of karma, you know, good karma goes around and comes around. And we have the street saying, what goes around comes around. Have you ever heard that? So the idea is, you know, you go out there with positivity and you know, it'll come back to you in positivity and you're, you know, we had some very kind of, but it actually, it wasn't all that far-fetched, and it served me well, as a matter of fact. So I took off for Ethiopia. Now, it's quite a long story. We don't have a long time. I'm trying to write a book about the whole journey, and it starts and it kind of, so hopefully make dua that we actually complete that. But it is an amazing journey, and every part of it is just amazing. And we'll just try and mention some of the things that might be relevant. So anyway, so I leave from California and I'm headed towards Ethiopia. And the path that I take is that I go to New York, and the journey from here to New York also was very interesting. I'll talk about that now. But then ultimately from New York, I took a plane to Luxembourg, and from Luxembourg over to Paris, France, and then down through France, and then into Spain, and down through Spain to Morocco. And my route was through North Africa over to Ethiopia, because as I said, I wanted to see the Muslims also, because you know what Malcolm had mentioned about that, so I wanted to actually just pass through North Africa on my way to Ethiopia, which means I have to go through Morocco, Algeria, Tunisia, Libya, down through Egypt and Sudan, and then ultimately to Ethiopia. So, long story condensed, I get to Morocco, and it happens to be Ramadan. The very beginning of it was, of course, there's no coincidence. Everything is planned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I reach Morocco, and it's just the beginning of Ramadan, and the whole country is fasting. Now, as I mentioned, you know, I used to, you know, we learned this kind of fasting like they do in India, you know, like the monks of India, they go on these water fasts, you know, like for a week, we would just drink water, no food for a week, and you get pretty, it gets pretty intense, but it really, you just feel a cleansing and you feel a spiritual kind of high, and it was wonderful. So I was a great fan of fasting. I used to do that all the time. So now I come to this country and the whole country is fasting. Of course, they have a different type of fasting, you know, from the morning until the evening, but nevertheless, the whole country is, yeah, they said, yeah, even our king, he fasts. I said, really? Wow. So I just had intended to just kind of pass through Morocco, but I ended up staying there for about 6 months. And I spent the whole Ramadan there, you know, fasting with them and bringing the fast, and it was magical. You know, and it was just amazing. And then, you know, a lot of things happen in Morocco, just amazing. But, and then ultimately being a musician, musicians connect with musicians everywhere, right? So I ended up connecting with Moroccan musicians and we traveled around. And they were actually traditional Moroccan musicians, which is a very, there's a name, I forget the name of that, just a specific type of, they're old traditional instruments. And I met them in Goulamin, which is, you know, on the end of the Morocco and towards the Spanish Sahara, and near in the land of the Tawarik, you know, the blue men, they call them. You see those guys with the black turbans and the blue. So I joined up with them, and so we went to all these little villages, you know, putting on our musical shows, you know, playing music, you know, usually in the marketplaces, very interesting. And there's a lot I can say about that, but I would just mention one important incident. And that was whenever the Adhan, and these places, these villages, the Mu'adhins, of course, they would, you know, call the Adhan from the minarets, and they didn't have microphones in those days, you know. They would just have these big voices, and they would call this Adhan. And I have no clue what they're saying, but it was just mesmerizing. So whenever the Adhan, and actually that's what Nabi Sallam told us, when you hear the Adhan, stop and listen. Why? Because it's a da'wah tamma. Allahumma rabba hadhi ad-da'wati at-tamma. It's a code. Well, I had no clue about that, but it was just mesmerizing. I was just, you know, just sort of, you know, just taken away with this. So whenever the Adhan was called, I would just stop and listen to that. And I would just, you know, really love that, you know. And so my companions, now this is very interesting. Now my companions, they're Muslims, albeit musicians, and musicians are pretty much musicians everywhere. They have the same kind of lifestyle, but along with that, they're Muslims inside, you know. They never prayed, they were doing all the things the musicians do everywhere, but they were, nevertheless, they still had Islam in there. So when they used to see me listening to this Adhan, so one of them, his name is Mahmoud, and he came and he said, look, you know, you're our brother and you're really one of us, but we want you to really become our true brother and become a Muslim and pledge allegiance to King Hassan. I said, it's very interesting in Morocco, you know, they really, because Morocco has a very interesting history, you know, it wasn't a country which was overpowered. It's like Yemen. You know, they themselves accepted Islam, and there's a barakah of that. Anyway, it's a very interesting history. And, you know, so they, even till today, they really hold, they call the, you know, the king of Morocco, they call him Amir al-Mu'mineen, still, you know. And in any case, so I said, well, I have no intention of pledging allegiance to your king, that's for sure. As for religion, as a matter of fact, that's what you know, drew me away from America. And that's actually what I'm searching for. I got kind of sidetracked here with you guys. But that's actually what I was supposed to be doing, you know. But I don't know about your Islam, you know. I can't say anything. If I thought that was what it was, then I'd accept it. But to be honest, I'm not ready to do that. I don't know what Islam really is. I don't know if that's really what I'm looking for. So in the meantime, in Morocco, I'm seeing various things that are very impressive. One is, as Malcolm he mentions this, you know, that, you know, there's no racism in Muslims. At least he didn't perceive any, not to say that there isn't. Unfortunately, we all know that unfortunately there is some element there. We're all humans, you know. But for all practical purposes, you don't see it. Definitely, you don't see anything like what you see in the West, and particularly in Morocco and North Africa, particularly. Really, I don't think there's any kind of racism. I didn't see anything like that. Moreover, I stayed in a place called Issawira. Among the various places I stayed for some months in Issawira with a family. It was one of the most beautiful times I had in my life, actually. And so the father was black as coal. I mean, black like that bag. And the mother was white as snow. She was just, you know, some people in Morocco, they're, you know, I would be considered dark compared to that. And the children were all the color of the rainbow. Mm-hmm. some darker, some lighter, and you know, and that just was beautiful, you know. So you had all these different colors in one family, you know, and that was typical of Morocco. You would see every type of color from darkest to the lightest and everything in between, and no sense of, you know, hey, you know. Yeah. And the other thing was the differentiation between the economic classes, which is extremely pronounced, as you all well know, you know. To give a case in point, you know, if a black person were to come in Beverly Hills, you know, particularly in that era, you know, back in the 1960s, probably still the same way. If someone, you know, shows up from that era, from the ghetto, shows up in Beverly Hills, within 5 minutes, he's going to be surrounded by police, right? Now, down in the ghetto, and a case in point, like in my music, you know, days, we were playing in a nightclub down in the ghetto somewhere. And so in the middle of we're playing our music, and somebody comes in with a pistol, and he's looking for somebody. You know, and this is a common occurrence, you know, in these kind of clubs, you know, and you'd always have to be on your, you know, ready to dive, you know, at any time. So this guy comes in, and he's, fortunately, the guy he was looking for wasn't there, otherwise it would have been pretty hot. And then he didn't find the guy, and he left. Now, the club closed up at 2 o'clock in the morning, right? Which was about 2 or 3 hours later. And while we're packing up all our instruments and everything, then a couple of policemen come, say, we heard there's some problem going on around here. There's having some trouble. So, well, officers, that was about 3 hours ago, you know? Oh, okay, yeah, just checking, you know? So there's a huge, you know, disparity, you know, differentiation between the classes. Now, in Morocco, you don't see that. At least, you know, you don't see it like you see it here, you know? The rich and the poor, you really can't differentiate them. In the street, you wouldn't be able to differentiate them. And the love of charity, spending on others, you know, hosting others, you know. In Libya, fast forward, in Libya, you know, I remember that there was actually when I came to the place where Gaddafi, actually, where he was from, Sirte, it's a place in Libya on the way, it's a small place, actually. And by that time, you know, I'm sorry, I learned some colloquial Arabic. And since I was, you know, fed up with America, so I had everything of American and their culture. So I was wearing, you know, a turban. I had a black turban, like the Tawadik, you know, that I used to play with. They gave me this black turban. I used to always wear that. And I had this long jalabiya. And I really loved those clothes. So in Sirte, I was eating, I was having a lunch. I got there on a bus or something. I was waiting for the next bus. And in the meantime, there's a policeman standing behind me. And very nicely, they waited for me to finish, and they said, look, you come with us. I said, oh, what's this? So they took me to the chief of the police, and I knew, salam alaikum. I knew a little bit of Arabic, actually, by that time. And I said, alaikum salam. I said, so where are you from? I said, I'm from the United States. He said, what are you doing in those clothes? I said, I can wear whatever I want. What's the problem? No, you can't. What do you mean? You have to wear the clothes of your own people, you know, otherwise we're going to put you in jail in Tripoli. What's wrong with this guy? You know, amazing. It's really strange how we, you know, have been twisted around. Anyway, so I said, hey, you know what? I don't have any other clothes. You know, he said, well, you better get some, otherwise we're going to send you back to Tripoli. I was actually going to Benghazi. Coming from Tripoli, I was sent back to Tripoli and put you in prison. This is bizarre, you know. And don't try anything because we're going to send this guy behind you. And so you go and get those clothes changed. Okay. Now what am I going to do? So I go back to the little matam, they call it, you know, little side, you know, people from those areas, you would know that, a little side place for eating. And my stuff was there. So by the time I get there, a bus had just come. And those guys were trailing me, you know. So I pick up my stuff, I jump on the bus, and the bus went, and I made it out. Okay, now on this bus, very interesting. So now the bus stops, one fellow gets off the bus, and he goes and he buys a whole big bag of almonds.
They grow almonds there in Libya, you know. So, and then he gets on the bus and he distributes it to everybody in the bus. So, must be some group, you know, they're all traveling together and, you know. So, everybody gets almonds. Okay, then the next stop, some guy got down and he bought a whole bunch of these boiled eggs. In North Africa, that's one of the things, you know, I think everywhere, even in India, Pakistan, everywhere they do that. So, he got a big basket of boiled eggs and distributed to everybody on the bus. Okay, fine. At around Maghrib time, so we got done and we all ate in, you know, one of these roadside little cafe type of things, you know, stands. And we had couscous. Anybody from North Africa? Right? So, you know, couscous, of course, yeah, right? And every country has its own couscous, by the way. Moroccan couscous, Algerian, Tunisian, Libyan, everybody's got their own style of it. Anyway, so we all eat couscous. And that's the dinner. And then now they're fighting with each other. Who's going to pay for everybody? In America, they're going to fight. Who's going to, you know, you pay. No, you. And these guys are fine. No, I'm paying. I'm paying. It was almost going to get physical. You know, okay, now we get to Benghazi. And then everybody goes a separate direction. In other words, nobody knew anybody, actually. So why were they? So now I'm getting an idea. These people are—they're different. They're totally different from the West. They have this karam. They have this generosity. They're not racists. You know, they don't put this importance on material values. And you know, of course, you see a lot of other, you know, not so positive things. But you know, if Allah will show you things. So a number of things like this, you know, I was seeing. And it's also interesting that I had to go to continue my journey. I had to go to Egypt. And at that point in time, I think there was generally skirmishes going on between Libya and Egypt from time to time. And that was one of the times when it was ongoing. And so they wouldn't let you actually continue by road. So I had to take an airplane from Benghazi to Cairo. And to do that, I need a visa to leave the country. So I go to the place, you know, I have one day because I have a flight, I think the next day or that night or something. So I go to the place where you have to get that, and it was closed. And what am I going to do? You know, just, you know, I have to get on the, I can't get on that flight if I don't have this exit visa. So there was a fellow, maybe probably a janitor or something like that, cleaning perfume. He saw me, he said, what's your problem? I said, I need to stay. He said, today is the Milad al-Nabi. This is the birthday of the Prophet. Everything's closed, you know, sorry, forget it. I said, I have this flight, I have to, you know, what am I gonna do? And the guy can see I'm really, you know, I'm really kind of upset. He said, okay, give me a minute. So I don't know what he did, but he took off. Now this guy's a janitor, by the way, you know? So he comes back. He opens up the thing and he gets a stamp and he stamps it away. No, really. So how? So this guy, he doesn't know me. He never saw me. But what? You know? Why did he go out of his way to do this? You know, this was really impressive. You know. So when people ask me, how did you accept Islam? Who invited you to Islam? Nobody did. It was actions. All these people by their actions. This is a very important lesson for all of us, you know. And most of us who accept Islam, this is how we do, this is how it happens. You know, there's very few of us who go through an academic, you know, really an academic research and, you know, that happens, but that's far, that's very few, you know. So anyway, so I get to Egypt and then there's so many things, you know, happen in Egypt. A very interesting thing in Egypt. People ask, what did you say the kalima? And actually, I didn't, there wasn't a real, like, okay, say the kalima. There was anything like that. But it's interesting that in Egypt, so I get to Egypt, and when I got to Cairo, it was such a noisy place. I got such a terrible headache. I actually wanted to stay there for a few days, but I couldn't stay there. I was right down in the middle of Cairo. It was so loud. You know, people, you'd go into a restaurant, And you know, you've got all these pots of different stuff. And you got this guy with his big, you know, spoons, and he's playing drums, you know, on all of these pots. And it's just so noisy that I got this severe head. I had to leave there. But one of the interesting things that happened in Cairo, and I was staying in one of these, they call pension, one of these really cheap places down in the middle of Cairo. And so there was a fellow, some sort of Sufi kind of guy that was used to just stand. He was working in that pension, but he used to just stand back and look at me, you know, kind of studying me, you know. And so then after a while, then he came up to me and he started telling me to say certain things, you know. And, you know, being from this hippie background and all this spiritual mysticism and all that, I thought, okay, he's doing something mystical and spiritual. I think he was actually teaching me Fatiha. Interesting. So now in Egypt, so I have to go to Sudan. Now to go to Sudan, I have to get a visa, obviously. And it's not that easy for an American in those days to get a visa. They're not very accommodating. It's not like a tourist place, Sudan, right? Neither is Ethiopia, you know, for that matter. And so now I'm wearing this turban and all this, you know, stuff. And so when I come to this Sudanese consulate or embassy, whatever it was, so the guys look at me and they say, "Are you Muslim?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "Do you know La ilaha illallah Muhammad?" And I just heard him, being a musician, we pick up everything very quickly. La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. Oh, okay. You know, you're good to go. You know, so I suppose that's the first time I actually said the kalima. I don't even really know what I'm saying. But anyway, so I get into Sudan. Sudan was also just amazing. Just amazingly. But now we're going to have to go back. I went a little bit ahead. So leaving Egypt and going to Sudan, you have to actually, you know, I went down the Nile. You have to go all the way down the Nile. And then you come to the border, near the border, a place called Aswan. And then after Aswan, you have this big lake called Buhayra Nasir. And it's a huge lake that's, you know, ends up in Sudan, in Wadi Halfa. So on that boat, it was like one of these old, you know, Huckleberry Finn, Tom Sawyer, you know, did you read Mark Twain, those old boats with the paddle wheel? That kind of a thing, you know. But it didn't have all the stories like the Mark Twain thing. That was a pretty fancy one. This was just a flat boat, and it had people and animals and cargo and everything on that boat. It also had a group of Sudanese camel traders. I mean, these were Bedouins from the desert, and they used to take their camels up to Egypt, I suppose, and sell the camels, and they would come back. So this group of camel, you know, traders, they were coming back, and they would call the adhan and pray their salat in Jamaat on the boat. And North Africa, being a Maliki, you know, these are all Maliki countries, and in the Maliki madhab, it's not allowed for the non-Muslims to enter the masjid. And Imam Malik, he has a strong argument for that. Others may not agree with that, but so the case is that in North Africa, particularly Morocco, I mean, you don't go into mosques, you know, that's taboo. And so I always wanted to go in the mosque and see, you know, being, you know, that's what I was looking for. But, you know, I never, you know, did that, because not being a Muslim, I thought you can't do that. So I never actually saw the Muslims praying in Jamaat. And the people I was hanging out with in Morocco, they were not people, you know, who would be engaged in all of those kind of things. So now here I have a front row, you know, vision of Islamic song, the prayer. And they're calling the adhan, and already this adhan, you know, that's just really mind-boggling for me. So I'm just loving this adhan, and now they all stand up and off their salat. Now, a group like all of you, because you have, probably most of you, if not all of you, have grown up in Muslim homes, and you've been seeing salat all your life, right? So when you see people making salat, does that seem like an amazing thing to you? No. But you know what? If you've never seen Salat before, it is the most amazing thing you would ever want to see. A life-changing experience. And so never seeing this, you know. Now, after they call the Adhan, and the Imam stands up and the other five, six, seven, however many they were, I don't remember. And they stand up in this straight line. Now, if you would go to a church or you go to a synagogue or any of these places, you don't see anything like this. This discipline, this focus, this concentration, there's nothing like that. You know, in churches they sing some songs and recite some hymns, and people are kind of, you know, sitting around. It's just really not very solemn and sanctified, you know. Here, these fellows all stand up and they say, Allahu Akbar, like one body, Allahu Akbar, and like, you know, focus. And I'm just sitting here looking at these guys. Wow. You know. And they are, like, they are, you know, when I'm talking about connecting with the Creator, these guys are connected, you know. They are, like, cut off, Allahu Akbar, cut off of everything and now focused on, and their eyes are all in one place, their hands are in one place. And then the Imam says, Allahu Akbar. And then, like, one body, and I'm just like, wow. And then, when they all went into sajda, and never seeing this, by the way, so that's it. That is it. That is the ultimate. There's nothing, that is the most, that is the most connected you can be. Not only was I seeing that, you know, this prostration on the ground, you know, this is like, this is the ultimate of humility in front of the Creator. But not only that, it's a collective humility, you know? So it's, and this was the main dimension that was missing in all these other isms that I had been studying or that I had been attracted to and ultimately, you know, lost interest in, because there was nothing really to bring about a social and overall change. And mind you, that was one of the, those were the big issues for us. The social injustices, you know, the economic injustices, you know, the destruction of the earth, and. So what about all of that stuff? What do you have for that? Well, not really anything. So here I'm starting to see that this is a collective thing. This is not just an individual thing. There's an individual connectivity. There's a connectivity in the community. There's a social connectivity with the one. So I'm just looking at this. I said, whatever religion that is in, that has to be right. And I know very well what religion this is in. So what does that mean? It means Islam is what I'm looking for. And I'm already starting to understand that. But, you know, I've come all this way to become a monk in the Ethiopian mountains, you know. So what about that? So I just, you know, and just as on a side note, this sajda, you know, and, you know, what this can mean for non-Muslims, you know, and so that we appreciate what we have. I mean, when you're born in something, you know, you don't, you know, a person is born with a silver spoon in his mouth, you know, he doesn't really know. But a person who had, you know, plastic in his mouth and then he gets silver, you know, he appreciates it, right? So fast forward, you know, 1973 in Brooklyn. State Street Masjid. Anybody's been in State Street Masjid in Brooklyn? If you haven't, I would suggest go and see it. Don't leave the world before you see it, because that's an iconic masjid in America. And there's a lot of history in that masjid. And I won't go into that, but there is a lot of extremely important history of how Islam started in America from that masjid. In any case, we were in that masjid, 1973, middle of the night. There's a big bang on the door. We were in Jamaat, you know, we just joined Tabligh in those days, you know. And so this big bang on the door. And Brooklyn is, you know, now it's gentrified and all that, but it used to be an extremely dangerous place, right? So a knock on the middle of the night, you know, that could mean anything. So we're like, okay, what's this? So we said, who is it? He said, let me in, I want to become a Muslim. Okay. So this is a young Puerto Rican brother from the lower west side of Manhattan, which is even worse than Brooklyn. I mean, that's, you know, did anybody see the West Side Story? There was a famous movie and musical about that, the gang wars and all of that. It was a tragedy kind of thing. But it was extremely dangerous area. Anyway, he comes in and he says, okay, what's your story? So he tells us his story. He said, actually, I was, you know, really doing well. I was married. I had wife and children. I had two jobs, economically set, good family, loving family, beautiful. And then somehow or another, I got introduced to heroin. I started taking heroin. I got addicted, obviously. And for 8 years as a heroin addict, everything just fell apart, obviously. You know, lost his jobs, his wife left him, took the kids, and he's now on his own, you know, trying to get out of that, which is next to impossible. And so he tried different types of rehabs and all of this kind of thing. Nothing. And it's almost impossible to, very few people actually can kick that habit. So then he says, so then I saw this picture of a Muslim performing sajda. Now he doesn't know anything about Islam. He doesn't even know how salat goes. But he sees this picture of a Muslim in prostration in sajda. And the same thing that hit me, you know, he said, if God will listen to anybody, he's going to listen to that guy who's got his face on the ground. And so what did he do? So he himself, he prostrated like he saw this guy in the picture. And he said, I spent the whole night in prostration crying to God, oh God, help me and get me out of this mess. The whole night. Okay, how many of us have spent the whole night in sajda? For half an hour, 5 minutes even. Sajid. The closest you can be to Allah is in the sajda. I mean, this is such a powerful thing. You know, we don't really realize probably, you know, myself included, but, you know, the treasure we have. Anyway, so this fellow, he says, I spent the whole night in sajda. He said, when the sun came up, then I got up and I found that I no longer have any desire for heroin. Can you imagine that? This fellow, 8 years a heroin addict, and now probably we can't because we've never been heroin addicts, but you know, if you have any experience about that, that's impossible. And this guy with one sajda, he's cured. So when we have problems and difficulties and needs for something, where do we go? And we're Muslims. And he wasn't even. So he said, so this happened, taken place. So he said, well, where's, you know, I want the rest of this religion, right? So now the rest of the day, he's roaming all around New York, and in New York was not like it is now. I mean, you had three or four places that, you know, something Islamic was going on once in a while, you know. And one of the places was this masjid in Brooklyn, which actually had five times prayer, which is very rare anywhere in New York in those days. So he was roaming all around, and then finally in the late night, he finds this masjid, and obviously he became a Muslim immediately. And then he reaches in his pockets and he pulls out everything he's got and he puts it down. He says, now, just take, this is what I have in the world, just take it and take me with you guys. Allahu Akbar. So anyway, so this sajda. So that's that. From that point, it was like, yeah, you are looking for Islam and there it is. But as I said, since, you know, I had come all this way and I had this whole big hype about, you know, going into the mountains of Ethiopia and becoming a Coptic monk. And so ultimately I went through Sudan and a lot of things we can talk about, all those places. But in any case, so I did reach to Ethiopia and I did meet with these monks. Now, the problem was that the thing that I observed about these monks was that no doubt they were, I mean, they were totally dedicated to whatever they were into. They had no connection with the world whatsoever. They were, you know, they were very simple zuhud, you know, as we say, and ibadah, and, you know, worship all the time. But the interesting thing that struck me about them, more than anything, I didn't really get into, you know, what all they were about, but the thing that really, you know, just turned me off from them altogether was looking at them, they had no light on their faces. You know, Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, those who have read hadith, they might have heard this story. So Umar radiallahu ta'ala was passing by and he saw these monks, you know, the same scenario. So I always remember this saying because it's kind of what I observed as well. So these monks were totally engrossed in their ibadah and, you know, their zuhud and their abstention from the world and all that. But ultimately, what's going to be the end result? Aminatun nasira, tasla naram hamya. So Umar radiallahu ta'ala, he was felt so, you know, sorry for these people. He said, their faces are just showing that the heavy effort that they're putting into, you know, and how that's even appearing on their faces. And the ultimate result will be tasla naram hamya. And ultimately they go into the hellfire because of the wrong aqidah and not accepting Muhammad's laws. Anyway, so this is what I saw in these people. With all that, but there was no light on their faces. They were not enlightened, you know. No. The truth is going to give you light. It's not going to give you darkness. It wasn't because of their skin color. It was because they were radiating darkness for some reason. On the other hand, Muslims, you'd have a Muslim trader, you know, pious guy, and he would, you know, have his tasbih in his hand, you know, and his mark of sajda in his forehead, and he'd be sitting in his shop, and he would be like a lantern, lit up, you know, full of light. You know, it's the characteristic that you would see, you know, in Muslims. These guys are all, even though they're apparently engaged in their worldly professions and all that, but they're connected with them. These guys are totally no light. No, that doesn't make sense. So ultimately, I decide, you know, that's what I need to do. And it's also interesting that I, one last sort of interesting thing in Ethiopia. So I was traveling all around, you know, various villages in Ethiopia, as I, you know, was my want. And I ran into this guy who was kind of this, he used to call himself a sportsman. What did he mean by sportsman? I mean, he used to do these really weird things, and he used to put on shows in the villages, you know, like the Moroccan musicians in this case that go in the villages, and he put on this show of this sort of, you know, masculine and macho kind of feats, like, you know, you put a big boulder on his chest and smash it with a sledgehammer and he's okay, you know, and drive over him with a car, and I mean, he was a pretty tough guy actually. And so he used to put on this kind of show. So he, in this village I happened to be, little village, so I was walking by and he saw me, and, you know, who are you, where do you come from? So it transpired that, yeah, I'm a musician and I'm roaming around here. And so he said, okay, join me because I've got this show and you can play music and we'll have a good time, you know, we'll do good. I said, okay, fine. So we traveled around various villages, you know, putting on these shows. He'd do his thing and I would play music. And then, now every place, and the interesting thing was everywhere we used to go, and Ethiopia is about 50% Muslim and 50% Christians, which maybe a lot of people don't know that, but that's the fact. And so I would be naturally gravitating toward Muslims. And he was not a Muslim, by the way, he was a Christian. And Christians and Muslims, they have issues, you know, among themselves. They coexist, but they had issues. And so me gravitating to the Muslims, really, it didn't go well with him. He didn't like that, kind of irked him. And then ultimately we were in a village, came to this village, a little village with dirt roads, a little place. And I was walking down the street and this fellow comes running up from behind. And this fellow, he says, hey, I heard that there's an American Muslim in our village. Are you him? Well, I can't imagine any other American in this village in Ethiopia. So I guess it must be me. I said, I guess that's me. I can't imagine. So he took my hand. Oh, yeah, you're a Muslim. Yeah. So what did you see there? So he said, well, you see, look, in your hand, you see this is 1 and this is 8. Very clear in your hand, which actually it is. He said, that's 18 and this is 81. 8, very clear. See, that's 8 and that's 1. 99 names are clear in your hands. You have to be a Muslim. Subhanallah, Allah subhanallah has his own ways of, you know, doing things, you know. It's amazing. I said, okay. And as I mentioned, it was just, I just needed a little push, right? I'd already been saying since North Africa, you must, yeah, so, but now, yeah, I'm Muslim. Yeah, okay, now it's done. So then he took me to his friend. His friend was some kind of soothsayer, and he looked in his book, there's all kinds of fortune telling, weird stuff, you know. Anyway, so it turns out that this fellow, he's an English teacher, actually. So he knew some English. He was an English teacher, and his name was Adam. I remember his name from now. So he took me home to his house. And in Ethiopia, you know, anybody from Yemen or from Ethiopia? One brother from Ethiopia met me. Yeah, from Ethiopia, Al-Qat. You know Qat? Yeah, so everybody eats this Qat. It's kind of like a heavy, it's like drinking about 4 or 5 cups of coffee, you know, and it really, you know. So they all chew that stuff. So he took me home, and we're chewing this Qat. And in Yemen, he must have seen that also. Yeah. So, and then he teaches me the Arabic alphabet. So I learned Alif, Ba, Ta, Tha, Jim, you know, in the Akhiri, in that night. You know, they learned the alphabet and night and oh wow. And then the morning. So I decided, okay, now I had enough with this guy and roaming around this, you know, I'm gonna go back to Addis Ababa and I'm gonna learn Arabic and now I'm gonna do it. You know. So then my buddy, you know, I tell him I'm going back, he said, oh, what do you mean? We're doing great. And he started crying. No, I'm going. So I went back to Addis Ababa and I don't know anybody really. So I went down in Addis Ababa. You know Addis? Are you from Eds? Are you from Addis Ababa? From Yemen. We had somebody from Ethiopia here earlier. Yeah. Where are you from? From Addis? So I went down to Mercado. You know Mercado, right? There's a big masjid in Mercado. You know that masjid? Huh? I don't remember the name. But anyway, right next to that big masjid, they had these little rooms, which in those days cost 50 cents a night. And the room was about big enough for you to sleep. That was it, you know. It was like room that was subdivided into little cubicles. And you know. And so those young workers or laborers and people like that were living over there. But all Muslims were there in the area. There was some Nigerian guy, I think from Nigeria, the Sheikh, who also was staying there. So anyway, Now I want to go, I'm here, I came down here because I want to become Muslim. I am a Muslim now and I want to learn to pray and all that. So I went to these young guys, hey, I want to learn how to pray. I'm a Muslim now and I want to learn how to pray. Can you teach me? Well, I don't know exactly, but let's go see if he knows. So when did this guy, nobody knows how to pray. I'm like, what's this? So they said, okay, what you do is just the mosque. Just see what they do and just do what they do and you know, you'll be okay. It's okay. Sounds good. So I went to the mosque. Now again, keep in mind, also Ethiopia is not a tourist place, you know. They're not used to, you know. In fact, Ethiopia has a very interesting history in that it's one of the few places that they didn't allow colonists to take them over. Italy was there for about 7 years and they kicked them out. So the Ethiopians are very proud and very, apprehensive of foreigners, you know, because they've always been able to keep their independence and always that's being threatened. Anyway, so it's not a place where they invite tourism, you know, anybody comes from by, and I don't look like an Ethiopian, I don't think, you know. So I was pretty, you know, like, who's this? So, So anyway, the first salat that I go, I go down to the masjid. It so happens it's Juma. It's actually Juma salat. So I come into the masjid. I'm right in the back row. It's already full. And so I just get in line in the back. And then the khutbah was going on. And then they stand up for salat. And then I just, Allahu Akbar, okay. What are they doing? Okay. So I'm just following whatever the people are doing. And I'm just doing that. And I was okay for that. I mean, nobody noticed anything. So then after the actual Juma Salat, so now after the Salat, then I come out of the masjid and I see that people are offering Sunan Nawafil. So I said, oh, I guess I should do that too. The problem was is that I didn't remember the sequence exactly right, you know. And I wasn't sure when you make Sajda, do you actually put your face on the ground or just above it? So I messed up somewhere or the other. I wasn't doing it right. And so people noticed that this, hey, who's this guy? And all of a sudden, a whole big group gather around me, and I'm, you know, and it's like, and you know, that, and oh my God, my first prayer, and it's going to be the last one, too. And so I thought, oh, my God. So then, it mysteriously, somebody again came up, said, they all left. So then from there, so I realized I better get my act together. You know, I need to learn this thing properly. So anyway, I left from there and I went to a place called Harar. You've been in Harar? It's a very, that's one of the seats of there. It just, what a wonderful time. So I spent my first Ramadan actually as a Muslim in Harar. There's Diri Dawa and then Harar. And wonderful. I can go on and on about Ethiopia. That was just an amazing experience. But anyway, the problem was in Ethiopia, as I mentioned, you know, a foreigner there, an American, you know, as a Muslim, they couldn't figure that out. So the intelligence community really had a problem with me. I mean, every day, particularly when I got the Harar, which is the Muslim stronghold. And since that was during the time of the King Haile Selassie, and there was a lot of strife between and oppression, actually, on the Muslims. So this guy, what's he doing here, you know? So every day they would actually take me down to their center and interrogate me. What are you doing here? And the guy said, I came here to be a Muslim. Said, come on, what are you doing here? You know, they couldn't believe that I'm. So they kept on giving me a lot of problems, and ultimately I went back to Addis Ababa after Ramallah was over. And then they gave me the advice that, why don't you go to Yemen? Because Yemen, you know, there, that's a totally Muslim country, and they'll be good to you and all that. So I went to Yemen. So then from Addis Ababa, I went down to Assab. You know Assab? It's on the Red Sea. So my idea was to just, you know, I heard about a Muslim who had a shipping company. So my idea was that if I can make it over there, then I would just request that, Phil, if you don't mind, just let me just get on your ship and ride over to Yemen. So when I got there, actually the Qadi of the Muslims, he heard about me and he demanded that I'd stay with him. And he said, no, you're not going to go on any ship. You're going to go on the plane and I'm paying you for your ticket. I said, no, you're going. Anyway, so then I go from Assam and I go to Taz. And then there in Taz, I stay for some time. And actually in Yemen, that's where I first really meet ulama, and they really start teaching me, you know, good things. And I'll just mention one important thing of Yemen. So it was an amazing experience, and there's so many amazing things in Yemen. But so when I the ulama who were going to Hajj, they said, you come with us to Hajj. I said, Hajj? You're kidding me? You know, that's like, you know, I couldn't imagine a new Muslim just became a Muslim and going on the pilgrimage to Makkah, you know, that's just, no, you come with us. So I said, okay. So I had to go to Sana'a, and I would have to get, obviously, the visa. Now, my passport doesn't show what I am now. It's showing what I was back in my music days, hippie, you know, the big hair and all this weird stuff, and with a different name also. By the way, my name Hashim, it was originally Hisham in Morocco. They gave me this name, the family that I was living with. And then when I got to Yemen, they said, no, make it Hashim. So I became Hashim in Yemen, actually. So anyway, I have to get this visa. So when I get to the Saudi Arabia, you're going to have to get a certificate that shows that you're actually a Muslim. You know, we need to do, you know, we need something with the Masjid al-Qadha al-A'la, from the top, you know, Islamic judicial authority. I said, okay, fine. So with one of my friends, one of the great scholars there in Sana'a, so he took me to the Majlis al-Qadha al-A'la, which was the Majlis of the Kibar al-Ulama of Yemen, you know, of Sana'a. And it was such an experience, I can't even begin to explain that, but it was all the Mashayikh, you know, they must have been 70, 80, 90, 100 years old, I don't know, and with all their jubbas and their imamas and, you know, these guys were small on another level. And so there's a whole council, a whole table full of them. And they're asking me questions, you know, how did you accept Islam, this and that. And much of it was translated. I couldn't really speak that well in Arabic. And so anyway, they asked me a lot of questions, and then ultimately they said, do you know anything of Quran? I said, I've done a few surahs. They said, can you read something? You read Fatiha? I said, yeah, I can read that. So I just read Surah Al-Fatiha, and they all just began to weep, you know. Ataakum ahl al-Yaman hum araqqu afidatan wa alyan quluban. And this, the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam mentions, is that when you look in the books of hadith, there are the whole chapters of the people of Yemen, the virtues of the people of Yemen. And really, it's the fact, you know, that they are softer in hearts and more, you know, of iman, iman in what hikmah yemeniya. Iman is from Yemen, and hikmah, wisdom, is Yemeni. You know, it was such a moving experience. And then I still have, and they wrote by hand, you know, this sort of taqreer that this brother has come before us in the Exodus Islam, and it was written in the very old, with the old kind of ink pens, you know, with the reed, you know, actually that you cut, you know, and then sign and stamp. I still have that document. And then, so subhanAllah. So then I, from Hudaydah, so I go back to Taz, and then I take the boat from Hudaydah to Jeddah. In those days, we go to Hajj on the boat, which is about a three-day journey. In the meantime, I'm getting sick all the time. I'm getting these big boils, and I don't realize this, but I'm developing an abscess in my liver, an amoebic abscess, which is now causing boils from time to time, and sickness and weakness and fever, but I don't realize what it is. Anyway, on the boat going to Jeddah, I became delirious, and I was semi-conscious. By the time I get to Jeddah, they have to actually carry me off the boat. And so my friend in Sana'a, he had a close friend in Jeddah who was, he gave me that address. And so he was a doctor as well. So luckily I was taken to him, and the next day was Yom Tarwiyah, in fact. So alhamdulillah, I was okay, and I went and performed Hajj, and some other ones going on about that, but no time. So after Hajj, actually, I wanted to remain there in Saudi Arabia. I wanted to remain in Medina, actually, and study there in the university. And that time, Shaykh Ahmad Aziz bin Baz, rahmatullah, he was the principal of the Jamia al-Islamiyah in Medina. And so a very interesting thing about Saudi Arabia in those days. So when I got there, so Shaykh said, welcome, ahlan wa sahlan, we would love to have you, but you're going to have to just get your visa changed because you came here on a visa of Hajj. You're going to have to get this change to student visa. No issue, just when Hajj is over, so when King Faisal is having his majlis, so you go and tell him you want to, and you know, he'll write something for you. That's how it was. Yeah. King will be sitting, you know, such and such, just get him to, you know, get your stamp, and you're good to go, you know. I don't think you can do that now, you know. But that's how it was, very simple. But then after Hajj, and I had gone back to Jeddah, and then I collapsed, and then I contracted hepatitis, and I contracted pneumonia, severe pneumonia, severe hepatitis, and then and it was really bad. So they admitted me in the hospital, and the hospitals in those days in Saudi Arabia were not what they are today, that's for sure. So it was pretty primitive. And then in the hospital, I fell off the bed, and I fell on the side where my liver is, which caused that abscess to break. And the fluid of the liver went into the lung cavity, and the lung was collapsed also. So it was pretty messy. And actually nobody in the hospital thought I was gonna live through that. But here I am today, 50 some years later. So at that point, I had to actually have an operation on the lung, and they were in no position, they couldn't do anything like that in Saudi Arabia. I mean, every afternoon, the room, like the windows were all broken, you know. And so every afternoon when there would be a wind, you know, and it was outside of Jeddah, which was a small, almost village in those days. And so the wind used to come, and the room would fill up full of dust and dirt, and then they'd have to sweep it out the next day. So it was pretty primitive. And so I had to actually get an operation, otherwise I'd lose my lung. I said, well, if I have to go anywhere, I'll come back here. So I came back here to the U.S. I came back to Los Angeles. and the operation was performed, and alhamdulillah, it was successful. And then after that, I had intention to go back to Saudi Arabia, but I thought before I do that, let me get a little bit experience in Arabic. So I entered into junior college, and being a high school dropout, by the way, because of my musical thing, I was never in school. So I never actually had, you know, I didn't have even a high school diploma. So I just went they have a test every year. So alhamdulillah, it's not that I didn't read and I wasn't interested in learning things, but I was interested in learning what they were teaching in the school. So anyway, so I just made two rakats and went into the examination. I did fine. So I got my certificate for that. And then I was studying Arabic language in Los Angeles City College for about a year with the intention to go back to Saudi Arabia. So on my way back to Saudi Arabia, I stopped in New York for a few days. I wanted to meet a friend of mine that had been in Medina. I couldn't find him, but I ran into the Tablighi Jamaat. And so the next thing I know, I'm roaming around with them for the next 4 months in America. And that itself could be a book, you know, that those early days of Tabligh and, people accepting Islam. And in those days, the only people who accepted Islam, now things have changed drastically. In those days, there was two kinds of people that would become Muslims. One were criminals off the street, like Malcolm X himself, or people like us, musicians. A lot of musicians actually accepted Islam, particularly jazz musicians. And we have, and some of them are still alive, actually, back in the 40s and 50s, people have been accepting Islam. And then after that, then I went to India and to Bangladesh and other places and then came back here to America and started a little business. And then by 1978, the calling to return to my studies and back to Arabia. And so 78, then I said my last farewell to America and left. And then the next 7 years in Makkah, then ultimately from Makkah, then I was deputed to go to Pakistan. And so 1985, we left the whole family to Pakistan. There I remained for the next 35 years or so. And in fact, my house is still there. A lot of the family is still there in Pakistan. Some of them are here. And the story goes on. And it's still ongoing. And that's pretty much the story. So that's the story. If there's any questions or anything, which I don't think you have questions about a story, but if so, well and good. Otherwise, yeah.
I wonder, you assalamu alaikum.
Walaikum assalam.
Thank you for coming. I wonder if you talked a little bit about what you experienced when you first saw the salah, the collective ibadah.
And
begins to talk about that collective kind of people were that thought.
Yeah.
People were fumbling over each other's debate. Yeah. I wonder if you have any insights in all of your times, how communities change in that collective state from place to place.
Well, that, that was one of the things that I was observing off of North Africa, this collectivity, collective living, they feel that they're part of a collective. We in America, where every man is an island kind of a thing. Actually, the Afro-American community, you have more of that. In the Latino communities, you have more of that because it's more traditional, culture. So you'll find that. But then living in this world where, in the environment where, the dollar is supreme, and that's basically our God and our Qibla. So, the collectivity, for what? Why? It's me and mine. So unfortunately, when we get separated from spiritual, the spiritual dimension of being human, and we, gravitate towards the material. So we start to lose that at the expense of that collectivity also. So it's part of our Islamic tradition, and obviously Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, he had Allah ma'al jama'at, the hand of Allah is with the jama'at, with the collective. Barakat of everything collective. Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala, he says a very interesting thing. He says three things produce barakah in your food. Saying Bismillah before, Alhamdulillah after, wa kathratul aidi, many hands in the plate. You know, and so you'll experience, barakah, you'll experience the blessing of Allah with the collective. You know, but even in these civilizations, and even places, and Morocco, I went back to Morocco actually a few years ago. It's changing. All these places, Pakistan, I saw 35 years in Pakistan, I saw, you know, moving away from these things. Otherwise, in all these places, wherever you have a Muslim culture or an Islamic culture, you've got this feeling, this very close feeling of collectivity, starting with a family. And we're losing that as well, you know, in the name of the American dream or anything of that genus, you know. So I don't know if that really answered your question at all, but but it's part of our sacred, it's part of the sacredness of our religion. It's a social religion. It's not a religion of monasticism. It's a religion of personal connection and connectivity with the rest of the creation. We're part of that creation. That's a very important aspect of our being. And many of us went up to Islam, we're attracted. It's one of the main attractions. So I don't know if that was useful enough. Anything else? Any other questions or comments?
Yeah, I've got a question. Throughout your journey, I'm pretty sure you went through a lot of challenges. The question is, what kept you going? Or was there something that you had to kind of do, like a mechanism or
Well, I tell you, it was all, as I said from the very beginning, I really don't have much to do with it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to manifest what he wants to manifest. And I think, really, I just, you know, have to keep saying this from time to time. I think the very fact that someone like me, you know, a hippie musician out of the streets of America who's now, you know, talking about deen, this is, you know, it has nothing to do with me. Allah uses who he wants. Take Malcolm himself, you know, a guy selling women and drugs and a criminal on the streets. He becomes the means of Islam. All of us who accept Islam in that era in America, Malcolm had something to do with that, much to do with that. Still today, you know, Imam Shaheed, you know, Malik Shabazz, rahmatullah alayh. And, you know, so the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to use somebody for something, it's out of their hands. That's one. The other thing is, how relevant it might be, but Imam Ghazali, rahmatullah, he says a very interesting thing. He says, there's two people, you know, that in tantadim lahum ad-dunya. You know, that dunya, they'll, you know, kind of cooperate with them. Two types of people. And he says, one is a muhawwir, and one is a mutawakkil. Muhawwir, a person, he's like this reckless fellow that he has something he wants to do. And, you know, America's famous for people like that, you know. Regardless, I'm going to do it, you know. And, you know, regardless of the consequence. So I think coming from that hippie, you know, sort of revolutionary background that we, you know, from the 60s, it kind of gave me and people like me that kind of, you know, drive to, you know, to accomplish something that we felt was important, you know. And as I said, the most important thing for me at that point, somehow it manifested that I need to connect with the Creator. I mean, there's nothing else that's really important now. So until that happens, you know, if someone feels that we have a need, I mean, look at the sacrifice is much greater than that people are making to come here to make dollars, to get a green card. You look at this border situation. I mean, I didn't go through anything like that. I pretty much, you know, was, you know, there was challenges. Yeah, okay, but it was pretty pleasant most of the time, you know. You know, so if somebody has something that they think is they're after something, they're gonna, you know, yuhawin alayhim. You know, it makes it easy for them, and ultimately, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, he'll make it easy for you. And I mean, it wasn't that tough. You know, in retrospect, yes, there was challenges, but like I said, for the dunya, people are making much more, you know, significantly difficult physically and otherwise, you know, challenges. So, you know, what's the deal? You know, you went through a lot of challenges, you're going through whatever you went through, you know, whatever you're, you know, so everybody's got that challenge and they have to go through whatever they have to go through to be where they are and get where they, you know, where they end up being. It's just everybody's challenge is a little bit different, I suppose. Well, no,
any more? JazakAllah khair, everyone, for coming. We want to thank Shaykh Hashim Ahmad and Shaykh Waldo for having this program at ICOE with the Mihraab Foundation. Allah bless all of you, inshallah. So to continue the Shaykh's program, inshallah, tomorrow, there'll be the program from 10 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. with a lunch break from 1 to 2:30. That is provided by the Mihraab Foundation at Cordova Academy. That's in Goodwin, inshallah. You can find the flyer and more details at mihraab.com. And inshallah, we'd like to pass it over for the shaykh for the final dua, inshallah, to close the program. JazakAllah khair, barakAllahu feek. Thank you for coming.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Subhanallah, bihamdihi, adad akhlaqihi, wa rida'a nafsihi, zina khushim, dhalika binati, ya Rabbil Alameen, sayyidan amalik. أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد كما صليت وسلم وبارك على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين. ربنا اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. اللهم اتمنى نورنا واغفر لنا إنك على كل شيء قدير. اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم من النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين وحسن أولئك رفيقا. اللهم ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا يا مولانا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم وصل اللهم وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين.